If you haven't heard about Anchor, it's the easiest way to make a podcast. Let me explain. It's free. There's creation tools that allow you to record and edit your podcast right from your phone or computer. Anchor will distribute your podcast for you so it can be heard in Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many more. You can make money from your podcast with no minimum listenership. It's everything you need to make a podcast in one place.
Go.
All right, everybody, this is the Prozone, and joining me today, it's been way too long since we've been trying to get this together, and it's finally together after months and months of mishaps and some fucking pandemic and all this other crap, but ring announcer extraordinaire Matt DeCourt is here today. Matt, how the hell are you today, man?
I'm doing great, Rick, and you know, we got together over the weekend a little bit, a little bit at the record store, and that was some good times, and like you said, this has been in the planning for
early
quite a while, but you know, better late than never, as they say. Very forward to our conversation today. I don't know what kind of roads we're going to travel, but I'm excited to see where the journey takes us. So,
well, as I said, I think yesterday, I said I'm not preparing for this. We're just going to shoot because you know, certain people, I just like to sit there and just talk.
Absolutely, that's how the best conversations come through, in my opinion.
Absolutely.
I'm right there with you, my friend.
So, Matt, when did you discover professional wrestling? And, you know, I think we talked about this yesterday. So.
Yeah, it was a while ago. I was born in 1988. And so by the time I discovered wrestling, I was, I think, around, I want to say, 9-10 years old. It was in middle school because I think my first experience with it was we were at a Halloween party, actually, and a friend of mine had a black coat on, a black tank top, and his face was painted white. And I said, "Who are you supposed to be?" And he said, "I'm Sting." And I said, "What's a Sting?" And so then I learned what WCW was, and I learned about the world of professional wrestling. And as I'm sure you know, in the mid to late 90s, the Attitude Era, the Monday Night Wars, with all the rage, everyone was watching wrestling, and
Absolutely. And
that's how I got into it, and been a fan on and off ever since, and definitely more on than not nowadays, that's for sure.
Yeah, I was gonna say, more on for me as well. I mean, I've been watching close to 40 years, I'm gonna be 45 in just a few weeks, and I discovered it in probably 1984, so, you know, it's been an interesting ride. I've never really stopped for more than like a year or two, so it's there are very little things I don't remember. That's why I'm called the professor. But you know,
exactly.
So, what was your earliest memory outside of that Halloween costume? I mean, that's kind of, I find that a little strange that somebody was a WCW character in that. You grew up in Connecticut?
Yes, sir.
So I find that kind of weird because, you know, we're in WWE territory. So
right. Right.
So,
well, I think at the time, I mean, I'm pretty sure like we were all watching both, you know, even some ECW when there. I would sneak that in every Friday nights when my parents would go out for, you know, to have dinner or go shopping or do whatever. And so they'd leave me alone and I'd throw that. And I was on TNN at the time. And so
that's right.
As soon as I saw the lights in the drive, I'd be like, oh, and, you know, trying to turn it off. But yeah, we would watch everything. I think it was just, like I said, it was at a Halloween thing. And so, I mean, that the character Sting at the time kind of lended himself to, you know, kids dressing up as him,
right,
you know, with the face paint and everything and all that. But yeah, I mean, we watched them both back then, I sure did. You know, my three favorites at the time were Stone Cold, The Rock, and Goldberg. And Sting was very close behind that. And then you had your Chris Jerichos, your Ravens, and all those folk. And it's always fun for me looking back and remembering the times, you know, from when I first got into it, and all the characters and performers of that era.
Why don't you tell us about how you got into it, into professional wrestling, the business side of it?
I became involved. More of a fan, I should say.
Yes, more than
a fan. Okay, all right, sounds good. Well, the story of my life has pretty much been right place, right time, and it's been like that for just about everything. In terms of wrestling, there was a time. Right now, I work in basically construction administration. Mm-hmm. And I have for most of the past few years, but there was a time where my degree is, believe it or not, in journalism, from the University of Rhode Island. Cheap plug. Oh, right. Awesome. There. That aside, you know, I always wanted to use it. You know, I always wanted to write stories. I wanted to be a sports or entertainment writer. And, long story short, I got into it late and it didn't really work out. But during that time, I did report for a local paper in East Haven. And one of the big things I took away from that gig was I got to meet and become friendly with a number of very cool and interesting people in the East Haven, North Haven area. And one of those people was Big Steve Tracy, the former Dave Paradise, one of the Paradise Alley Pro Wrestling Four with Paul Roma, Paul Perez, Mario Mancini. And he just asked me one day after we were talking about stuff for a news story I was working on. He said, "Hey, Matt, do you like wrestling?" And I said, "I sure do, Steve." And he invited me to go see a show, and I went as a fan, and I really enjoyed it. And a few weeks later, I was talking to him again, and I was actually about getting ready to leave the paper at the time. Like I said, it was just too late, you know, in my personal life to try and go into a career that doesn't pay very much to start off on.
Right.
And yep. So yeah, I had to, but either way, that's another story for another day. But, so I said, all right, yeah, no, I'd love to get involved. You know, it won't be a conflict of interest since I'm leaving the paper, and, you know, getting involved in a wrestling promotion would a childhood dream. And so he put me in touch with Mario. Mario put me in touch with Big Daddy, and I got my start doing commentary at like two or three matches a night on the big shows with Big Daddy. And, you know, him and I had a pretty good chemistry. You know, he's one of my mentors in terms of, you know, not just commentating, but also ring announcing and social media presence as well. He really pushed me with that. So, you know, big props to Big Daddy for that. And also just, you know, big shout out to Paradise Alley Pro Wrestling as a whole. I mentioned Big Steve, Mario, Paul Perez, Paul Roma. You know, they took a shot on me when they absolutely didn't have to, you know, and without them letting me, you know, get my feet wet and experimenting a little bit, there would be no Matt DeCour. You know, I probably wouldn't be sitting here talking to you right now. So always big shout out, big thank you to them. And yeah, so just getting back to that, you know, I did the commentary for a while, and there was a need at ring announcer one night, and Mario went up to me the week before the show, because we were running back-to-back weekends, and he said, "Hey, kid, can you practice in the mirror for me?" And I said, "Why is that?" And he's like, he points in the ring, he goes, "That's going to be you next week." And I was just like, whoa.
Wow.
So, and I always, you know, through what people had told me, I kind of knew that, you know, I had the quote unquote voice for radio or face for radio or whatever, whatever the saying was. But I never knew like I could be, I never had done anything like that really before, except for a few open mics with, you know, some friends, you know, rock bands. And, and it was really fun to pull it out of me. And the first time I did it, I was so raw. Like Bill Thompson will tell you, he saw me with the card in my hand and my hand was shaking like just uncontrollably. And just because I was so nervous / excited to do it. And now it's second nature and I absolutely love it. And I'm just so glad I got this opportunity, and I'm very glad I've been able to take it farther than I've ever could have imagined. So
that's awesome. So you took to it pretty good as far as the commentator for the shows as well. Like you said, you mentored under Big Daddy. Did you like, you know, I'm sure there's a sense of nervousness, but you took to it pretty right away. It's like, I know there's probably some botches, you know, maybe, I don't know, but, cause I'm nervous every time I turn on the microphone. So I always got to, if I'm doing something myself, I got to record it 3 or 4 times or else, you know, I mean, but sometimes I just fucking edit the show and just, you know, put it up as it is. So,
yeah. And that's one thing that, going along those lines, one thing that Big Daddy always taught me is that, you know, there's no such thing as a perfect broadcast. And especially with me, you know, I'm my own worst critic. And even if they're 10 out of 10 people I talk to, you know, whether it's, you know, commentary, ring announcing, interviews, what have you, say, oh, you did such a great job, there's always one thing, no matter how big or little it is, that's in my head that I said, I could have done that better. And but that's the thing is you know, I like to stay humble, and I know in this business how quickly it can all go away. And so I just remind myself to stay humble, stay hungry, and keep grinding. And again, I just want to see how far I can take it. So
Paradise Alley was the first promotion that you worked with. You branched out in the last, year and a half to different organizations as well?
Yeah.
With, say, Shut Up and Wrestle, Texas Strength, and there's another one there too, right? Another one.
Yeah, the most recent one is Blood, Sweat, and Tears. Paradise Alley Pro Wrestling original Dustin Flash Waller is in the main event picture there with Blood, Sweat, and Tears champion Lucas Chase. They've had a big feud going on, a big rivalry, and it's been brewing over the past few months. And you know, they've been on the Top Rope Report, Mr. Trivia, who I think you and I are both familiar with.
I've been on his show before. he's been on here before as well, and looking to get those guys back on here at some time in the future. They're a good bunch of guys.
Absolutely. Yeah. Fun little fact about them is that they were the first kind of podcast / interview radio show, whatever you want to call it, that I ever did. So shout out to those guys as well. And yeah. So they that's been building. They got they had a small ring in their last two shows that they did, but that was, I think, mostly because of you know, the guidelines with, you know, the pandemic going on, and, you know, they had to maximize the space and whatnot. But they pulled off two really good shows, and what they're doing is working, because when Flash came out that one time, he hit a big 450 on Lucas. The place just erupted, and that's how you know that's how you know it's working. So
I've seen some clips on Facebook, and I haven't watched the whole shows as of yet, but it seems like a really cool cool promotion, and that room that they're promoting in is really small. The venue. Yeah. I think what'd you say yesterday? That it's less than 100 people fit in there? Or no?
I don't know what the tops are, because you know, obviously I haven't done a show for them in the pre-COVID era. It was only in the current, you know, era, unfortunately. Right. But so it's kind of hard to gauge, because they had with the guidelines, you have to cap it at a certain amount of people. I'm not sure what the exact number is, but as far as I know, both their shows were sold out, and so that's a good thing. You know, I say that because not only is it a good thing because I want Blood, Sweat, and Tears to be successful, because I think they have a good thing going, but just for the independent industry as a whole, because they took the biggest hit. And unfortunately, you know, not all these promotions are like WWE, AEW, Impact Wrestling, where they can afford to put on empty arena shows with a TV deal and still get revenue to continue to produce. And I was very concerned that a lot of it was going to go away. And just based on the receptions, like I said, the fact that even though it was limited numbers, the people did come out, that gives hope that, you know, everything is, it may not go back completely to normal, but at the very least, it's going to be okay. So
I think prior to the pandemic, like, really taking over, the independent scene was, like, basically on fire, the hottest it's been in a number of years. It was, like,
for sure.
I think in one night in Paradise Alley, it was at the Annex. I was talking to Big Daddy, and he's telling me there's like six shows that particular night in state. And I was like, Jesus Christ, man, that's freaking crazy, because I'm just like, I'm always looking for shows. If there's not the Paradise Alley show, it's like, you guys are closest to me, I'll definitely go to you guys. But I'm always looking for other shows when there's nothing on. I was just like, you don't always hear about these shows. I'm just like, how is there six shows in the States? I remember for a long time, especially in the earlier 2000s, it was a very dark period in professional wrestling. Where it was like, you'd be lucky if you got one show a month or once every other month. I remember Connecticut Championship Wrestling was a group that would run every 2 months or something like that. And they were a lot of fun. Big Daddy actually did commentary right. on them too, I remember back in the day. So.
Oh, yeah. Oh, so yeah. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
No, I was going to say, just going along that, I mean, before everything stopped in March, there were independent shows up and down the, you know, New England tri-state area, probably at least two or three, yeah. Monday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, every weekend. And they were good houses there, too. So
yeah.
It was, and that's, like I said, that's a great thing, because you look at, you know, WWE and AEW, and they're going to need to get new talent at some point from places. Absolutely. So the more the independents thrive, the more these other promotions can. It's a very symbiotic relationship, and
right.
And I don't know if it'll go back to, you know, the volume that we had back in March and prior. But like I said, if we can get close, then that's a win in my book. So
I think right now it's like a testing period as to see what's going to happen. I mean, you guys just ran three shows in one day. I was there for a good portion of it. It was long. But it was fun and. It was such a relief to go and get out and go to a live wrestling show because, you know, prior to the pandemic, I was at pretty much, you know, you guys were running show once or twice a month, sometimes three times in a month. And I was, you know, it's, and then all of a sudden it just dropped off. And for 6 months, there's absolutely nothing. And so it's like, it was a big relief to actually get out and go to a show. And it was a lot of fun to see some see some familiar faces and see a bunch of new talent that came in to the venue too, which was also very cool that I had never seen in that promotion. So that was a lot of fun as well.
Oh yeah. And it, again, a lot of the same sentiments. And what was special about that to me was, you know, I had actually after I did one kind of like undisclosed, like, you know, YouTube only show for a promotion called WCWE a little earlier. But even then, that was the only one I had from March. Well, unless you also want to count the empty arena stuff that PAPW did, too. Yep. I was a part of the Big Jim Anderson Bull Dread match, whether I wanted to or not. I just kind of got sucked into it. But yeah, not counting those things, like up until last month, I just had that, you know, the couple PAPW things and the one WCWE undisclosed. And it was tough because, you know, I do what I do because I love it. You know, it doesn't matter if I make $5, $20, $50, $1,000, you know, I do it because this is some of the most fun I've ever had in my life. And it's a chance to show a different side of me that, you know, people at face value probably wouldn't, you know, realize that, you know, I like getting dressed up all nice in a suit, you know, every weekend and then, you know, say wrestlers' names real nicely into a microphone. So, but, you know, not having that, it was just so tough because, and not only that too, you know, there was no movies coming out, you know, which is something I like.
Right.
You couldn't go to the casino, no concerts.
Like that was the part that's the concert thing is the one that's killing me as well outside of professional wrestling. Cause you know,
for sure.
I'm always going to places like, you know, Cafe Nine or Toads or wherever to go to shows or the casino even, you know,
exactly. Yeah.
But nothing, everything that was coming up was just washed away. Like anything that was really cool that was coming up and then, ZZ Top was supposed to be coming to town, and that was just taken away because I was really looking forward to it, you know?
Oh, man, no, I can only imagine. I hear you. And that's kind of what was so great about it, because once August started, I went from, you know, basically, you know, having, you know, one or two things to all of a sudden having four shows, one of it, which was actually three in one day. Right. So, and, you know, I'm just very grateful that, you know, knock on wood, Connecticut's been doing real well and we've been able to do something. And, you know, big shout out to Blood, Sweat and Tears to Test of Strength. And of course, Paradise Alley for putting on, you know, being able to put on all these events and being able to do it in a safe manner. And again, a big props to all the fans that came out too for, you know, wearing their masks, you know, staying distance and following the rules, because without all that stuff, without those protocols, you know, we probably wouldn't be able to do this. So I'm very fortunate because I was getting pretty stir crazy towards a few months ago.
Yeah, me too. And I'm sure you've seen that I've spent quite a bit of money on wrestling merchandise just to keep myself, couldn't spend it at shows.
I've seen your unboxing videos, my friend.
Yeah, I've been buying, DVDs, autographs. I've been, I think I've amassed like a really intense autograph collection in the last like 6 months, which never really went too crazy on them. But once you start seeing little things, it's like, oh man, I need that. So it's, it's just. And I think I've also purchased something like 60 wrestling shirts in that whole entire time. So I'm just like, I need to calm down. I finally calmed down. So it's just like, it's becoming like a once a month thing rather than getting four or five packages a week.
So, as a fellow collector, I completely understand.
Yeah. I've noticed that you're a thrift store junkie as well, kind of like similar to me as well. Yeah. And we've discussed this before that you collect VHS tapes, DVDs, records, all sorts of random stuff and comic book stuff too, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. No, I'm a physical media junkie.
Me too.
Yeah. And so it's not only that too, but I'm also, like you said, a big collector of everything. Being an only child, I'm kind of fortunate, it was just one of those things. I think it was just because I was just so used to, getting what I wanted, whether that's a good thing or a bad thing, if I'm just like walking down and I'm just like, oh, this is CD looks cool, I'm just going to get it, thankfully I am, good with my money. I think I told you I just moved into a condo, very first time homeowner.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So I am smart with it, but if I see something good for, 10, 15 bucks, I can spare that, once every week. So.
Yeah. What drew you to, cause you grew up in an era where VHS tapes were kind of out of moving out, right? I mean, by the time you were getting old enough, what made you decide to start purchasing them? I think you started purchasing them.
It was one of those things where it was always just kind of fun to see like people's reactions. Cause we live in, the streaming era, as I'll call it now.
Right.
Where a lot of people are just doing away with, not only cable, but all kinds of physical media. Right. And I just remember a few years ago, I lived with a couple of friends, and one of them was dating a girl at the time. And she came over and she noticed, she's like, oh my God, you still have a VHS player? And she's like, do you have any tapes? And I was just like, oh yeah, let me show you what I got. And I have like a bunch of old Adam Sandler ones, like Billy Madison, Happy Gilmore. I think they actually settled on Twister with Bill Paxton.
That movie?
I got to admit, it's a pretty guilty pleasure for me.
No,
but,
yeah.
It's just one of those things too, every now and then, if I didn't have a wrestling show book, before the pandemic era, there was where I lived in East Haven, there was a Goodwill right down the street. So you go there, and most of the time they have like 50% off sales, like just about every other weekend.
Absolutely.
So,
Is that the one on Fox and Road? Is that the one you're referring to?
It's the one that's right over the Brantford East Haven line.
Gotcha.
Over by Brantford Hill.
Yep.
Yeah,
that's a good one. That's a good one because I lived over there, in between marriages, but the laundromat that's around the corner. That's where I used to go and do my laundry. So I used to spend all my time in that Goodwill, and I used to come home. Not only am I, similar to you with collecting physical media, but I'm also like a stereo junkie. If I see a stereo that's in a Goodwill, I'm just gonna take it and buy it, and just. At one time, I had stereos just stacked up in my fucking basement and stuff, and it's made me bond with Vince Russo not so long ago on social media, because he's also like a huge stereo collector as well. So
yeah, absolutely. I mean, there are times that I've walked in there and I spent $2, and I'll walk out, with like the Terminator, Halloween, and two Ted Nugent records, and. I'm just like, for $2, it's like, geez.
That's not bad.
It's like, I've done far worse things with $2 than, spend it on stuff like that. And like I said, it's just cool, too, because, with the VHSs, it's just something where, I got to admit, I'm a little weird in my philosophy, but it's just like, I just want people to remember it, and if I could be like a catalyst to that, like, oh my God, somebody still has this, it's almost like an antique, right now, kind of. And so that's my logic with that, is that it's just, you know, I like preserving technology from a bygone era. And
that's not a bad thing. That's not a bad thing. I got my 14-year-old. I have my 14-year-old son now is buying VHS tapes, going down to the thrift stores. We usually, when they come and visit, we go hit up every thrift store on your day, or Hamden. His big thing is collecting old, like, cartoons or, like, superhero stuff that's on VHS. Like, we actually got the 1960s Batman movie on VHS. Yeah, that and a bunch of those type. The Scooby-Doo, he's a huge Scooby-Doo fan and Hanna-Barbera fan. So he, you know, at 14 years old, and the last time I heard here this weekend, he actually hooked up the VCR and started watching a bunch of the stuff that we had. So it was kind of cool.
See, that's so cool to me, because like, all that stuff you mentioned, the Scooby-Doo, the Hanna-Barbera, that's what I grew up on right there.
That's all stuff I grew up on. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So that's the thing. I mean, if I was in your household, I'd probably be sitting right there with you guys watching it. So.
We'll have to arrange that sometime. So go through the collection,
my friend.
Yeah. So you also collect records as well.
Oh hell yeah!
And what's your primary thing? I remember yesterday you said you had a bunch of crates full of records. What kind of stuff do you got there?
You know, it's kind of funny because I got a couple of things at the store the other day, and I actually wanted to check and make sure I didn't have them on any other formats. Right. I wasn't quite sure because it just. It's gotten a little ridiculous, but it is under control now, thankfully. But
yeah.
my primary go-to is heavy metal. Heavy metal came along at a point in my life where I needed something to kind of latch onto and feel like a sense of belonging. And for all the stereotypes that people want to give the heavy metal community, it's one of the most accepting communities that there is. You know, I can't tell you the amount of times that I've been out waiting in line outside a club or a venue, and the guy in front of me is wearing had some crazy haircut, wearing like a leather jacket with all kinds of patches and smoking a cigarette. And he'll turn to me, look at my shirt, and he'll be like, "Dude, that's a killer shirt." And then you hit it off, and
you make friends.
You were talking to him the whole time, and. And that was always just so cool to me. And so, yeah, because of that, I like it. You know, I love all kinds of heavy metal, glam metal, new metal, thrash, death, all encompassing. If it's got metal in it, I'll at least give it a chance. And so,
What is your favorite band?
My favorite band is actually, they're pretty unknown even by metal, well, I shouldn't say even by metal standards, but they're a band called Nevermore.
I've heard of them.
I'm
not familiar. I think that's a little bit past the time that I was listening to that kind of music. But
their name. First started coming out in the mid-90s. I obviously didn't hear about them until about 2005-ish, I want to say. But they're one of the most unique bands I've ever heard. Definitely one of the most unique bands I've ever heard, and one of the best. My personal favorite, obviously, but their lead singer is a guy, rest in peace, Worl Dane. He unfortunately passed a few years ago, but he had one of the most unique voices, vocal ranges in heavy metal and hard rock. Their guitarist Jeff Loomis, for a while, he played exclusively 7-string guitar, and
really.
Oh yeah, and some of the chords and riffs and progressions and songs that he would do was just absolutely mind blowing. Not to mention the fact that his solos were both incredibly technical and ridiculously fast. And so, in my opinion, he's my favorite guitarist. I think he's the best guitarist on the planet. Obviously, there are some people that would debate that with me, rightfully so. But in my opinion, that at the very least, he should be considered up there in the top echelon of greatest all-time players. And it's just rounded out by a great rhythm section, Van Williams and Jim Shepherd. And together and the last album that they made together was in 2010. And one of the things I really liked about them was that all of their albums sounded different, but distinctly them, if you can kind of
a sound, but they progressed
right, and they changed it up, but at the same time you could hear a song and just instantly know it's them, no matter, you know, how it sounded. And
right.
their last album was kind of like the perfect combination of everything that they had ever done. Mm-hmm. And it was their magnum opus. And, you know, just the fact that, to me, they ended on their best work, it kind of just makes it, you know, it kind of sucks because at the same time, you want to see them continue. And, you know, like I said, with Worrell's passing, unfortunately, I don't think that's going to happen. But but at the same time, I mean, you know, it goes back to the age-old question. Is it better to burn out or fade away? So
there's many bands, you know, that I've my favorite band probably actually my two favorite bands probably continued way longer than they probably should have. One has been around for close to 50 years now, Cheap Trick.
Okay.
you know, forming in the early 70s. And as much as I love them, I do believe that they do come out with a good record every now and again, but some of it's kind of, you know, mediocre. Maybe they should have just saved all those good songs for a record and not put them out as frequently. But there's also R.E.M., you know, and I think that they had a couple stinkers in their later days, but I think the record that they closed with when they broke up was a phenomenal record. I love that. Are you a fan of black metal at all?
Not as much as other genres, but yeah, no, I will listen to it. And it's kind of crazy because like there's all kinds of subcategories too. There's like
some
black metal, like your Dimmu Borgirs or or, you know, some other bands. But, yeah, no, like I said, I'll give anything a chance. And some of that symphonic stuff is actually pretty cool. So
it's become really strange that there's so many subcategories. I mean, black metal in itself is a subgenre. But, yeah, I'm going to pull out a DVD. I was just looking for it. Sure. Have you ever seen, or Blu-ray, rather, have you ever seen Lords of Chaos?
I want to say I've heard of it, but I can't say for sure. Refresh my memory.
You know the band Mayhem, the singer?
Yes, his buddy killed his buddy.
There was a book. The book is phenomenal. And then there's a documentary as well. This is like the film based on the whole entire story. Starring Macaulay Culkin's brother. What's his name? Rory or whatever.
Wow.
But I just got this recently. I haven't opened it yet, but the story is a very interesting story. And I subscribe to like a horror Blu-ray thing, like a mystery box that I get every month.
Cool. So,
they give you four random horror Blu-rays, and this was in the last one. I got a little excited because I read the book before, and it was really interesting.
Mayhem is definitely their story for sure.
It's pretty crazy.
Let's just say it's interesting at the very least, but it fascinating in a weird way. Yeah.
But it is very fascinating. There was a lot of really weird news stories back in the day around that whole entire thing. That you go on YouTube, you can watch a lot of weird like news clips based on that.
Oh, yeah.
So you also mentioned that you did open mics, and I heard you at one time say that you performed in some garage bands here and there. Why don't you enlighten me? Tell me a little more.
There was nothing ever really too official. I have a couple of friends who are, you know, pretty good musicians. Like one of my friends is a very skilled drummer. Another one is a really good songwriter. He's also a pretty good guitarist. And for a while they got together and they had a band going. They would play local venues and they would, you know, do some open mic work at a place in West Haven. I believe it was called, Savin Rock, I think. Savin Rock Roasting Company. I think that's somewhere down in West Haven.
Yeah. I've heard of that before. I used to live down in that area.
Yeah.
I used to do a lot of that stuff there. A lot of like bands used to play there quite frequently.
Yeah. And so every now and then, because like I said, I always had a penchant, you know, for being like a front man or like, you know, an MC or something like that.
Right.
So they would say, oh, hey, do you want to do this song with us? Do you want to do this song with us? And, you know, every now and then I'd just be, oh, yeah, you know, we do a couple songs here and there. And there was one night in particular where I was, you know, getting ready to go to bed. I had a long week and it was on a Sunday. And so they were just like, oh, come on. You got to come out and do this. It's a glow light theme, this and that. And I'm just like, all right, fine, whatever. So I chugged a glass of a cup of coffee. I went down there in my Stardust mask. I had like some Mardi Gras beads that one of my roommates had lying around the house, some other crazy stuff I just threw on, and I looked like an idiot, and like I was just, you know, like pelvic thrusting the mic, rolling around on the floor. And I thought, you know, I was going to get kicked out. And that's kind of what I wanted, because I really just wanted to go home and go to bed. But lo and behold, everybody, like, I just didn't say everybody, but like half the people in there were coming up to me afterwards. They're like, dude, that was like, that was awesome. Like, you rocked out so hard on there. I was like, really?
Yeah, right.
So, yeah, no. And that's kind of when I kind of realized, I was like, yeah, I might be able to do something with this, you know?
Right. So going back to professional wrestling, I know last time I talked to you, you said you stopped watching for a little while. Obviously, you were getting older, college age, started chasing girls around. That's what happens at that age. And then you ended up getting back into it. And what year did you end up getting back into it?
I know exactly when it was. It was when did the WWE Network launch?
6 years ago, probably.
Yeah, that's exactly it, because it was
right.
It was right around the advent of network launching when I got back into it. And I shouldn't say that. I had started getting back into it in 2011, because before I took a hiatus altogether, which was around 2007, 2008, I was strictly watching TNA, Impact, whatever it was called at the time. And like Ring of Honor, CZW, and any other independent stuff I could find on YouTube at the time before there was all those restrictions and regulations and whatnot.
Right.
And so the reason why I kind of got back into it then was because in 2011, that was when CM Punk started really making a name for himself.
Right.
And he was one of my favorites at the time. You know, I'd watched the trilogy of matches that he had with Samoa Joe. Those were excellent. He was a gifted talker. He was unique in the ring. He had a moveset that I really hadn't seen at the time. That's kind of when, you know, I kind of got into that style of wrestling that, you know, the Ring of Honors, the Impacts were doing. And so when he started, you know, breaking out there, then that's when I started. I was really only paying attention to him, but there were some other things, too, that caught my eye. The Kofi Kingston / Evan Bourne, Matt Sydal, whatever he was going by at the time, tag team.
Right.
They were tag team champions. Unfortunately, that didn't last that long, but when it did, I thought it was really good. So that was kind of going on at the time, too. And so that kind of was in the back of my mind that was going on. But then, as the Punk run kind of fizzled out a little bit, then I started fizzling out again, too. But what brought me back to it then was when the network era started, was because all the other guys I was watching on the independents at the time, your Claudio Castagnoli's, who's Cesaro now, Daniel Bryan, you know, was getting to be his turn at WrestleMania 30, the Yeselmania, whatever they wanted to call it, that was going on. He was there. And then there were, the Seth Rollins. Dean Ambrose, the Shield was killing it, and to me they should have kept them together a lot longer than they did.
I feel that way. They had a really good run in NXT, and it's always when something really is awesome in NXT and then comes up to the main roster and then it just gets wiped out like relatively quickly. Yeah, so you get what I'm saying. It's like,
oh god, yeah. And
that's
speaking of which, too, what really sold me on getting back into it was the match that sucked me back in was I saw Cesaro wrestle John Cena. And at first I put it on as like me and my friend it was like a Saturday night. We weren't doing anything for whatever reason.
Yeah.
And they were doing like, you know, the 2-hour truncated version on some other, you know, USA offshoot.
Yeah, it's
network.
Like the replays.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so there was corporate Kane was a thing at the time. So we put it on. We were just ripping on that. We're just like, what the?
Right.
Like, Kane needs to be with fire and brimstone. What is it with the suits and the bald head? Like, no. So we were just ripping on that. But then Cesaro and John Cena came on. We were dead silent through the whole thing. And then after it was over, I looked at him. I was like,
wow.
That like a really good match, or was that just me?
No, I gotta tell you, like, that's one of Cena's best matches, I think, is I always knocked him because he was corny, but I always admired his work that he would do outside of wrestling, his charity work. So, you know, it's like, yeah, I think he's a boring wrestler, he's corny, but he's a really good human being.
Oh, sure.
And then I saw him wrestle Claudio, and I saw him wrestle CM Punk, where, you know, when they were doing the two belts, and it's the first time I'd ever seen John Cena actually mat wrestle and do, like, chain wrestling. I was just like, holy shit, this guy can actually match Punk move for move. So I ended up changing my opinion on him, but I still didn't become a fan. But, you know, I just...
I hear you, because I was in the same boat, you know, back in when they were doing the ECW One Night Stand, when he came out against Rob Van Dam, and people were just crapping. That was like freaking Mardi Gras for me. Like...
I thought it was hilarious, the sign that was held up, if Cena wins, we riot. And I was just like, it's true, though. They probably would.
Yeah, that crowd, they would have.
ECW.
They were torn down that ring.
That was just a warning. It wasn't a joke. It was a warning.
That wasn't. What does Paul Heyman say? It's not a spoiler. It's not a prediction. It's a spoiler or whatever.
Right. Yeah.
So, but I kind of feel the same way about that, too, because, you know, for a while it was a cool thing, you know, to make fun and hate on John Cena.
Right.
It's like you look at it, like, what were some of the best matches during the modern era? John Cena against CM Punk. John Cena against Daniel Bryan. John Cena versus Cesaro. John Cena versus Kevin Owens. What's the one common denominator there?
Cena, right. So he shows that he could just not be just a character. He could wrestle when he's put in there. You know, with the right guys and he can go move for move with a lot of these guys. So he just, you know, he's built up as a character to do a certain thing and get over and suck in that mainstream audience.
And that you summed it up perfectly there. And that's another thing we talked about too, was, you know, during this pandemic era is the no crowds. And the one thing that, you know, even if, you know, Cena was a little behind those other guys, the one thing that brought it back was the fact that no matter if they were booing him or cheering him, he always got the crowd to work with it. And that the crowd, especially in WWE and especially in NXT, that is played to me is what part is a big part of what makes it special.
The other thing about Cena is that he didn't care if he got booed. He embraced it. You know, he would sit there. He was still having a good time and he would smile and keep going. He liked it. And you know, it's like, I know you hate me, but they're paying me to do this, you know, so I'm doing it. You know, he would goof on it when he went out there. But, you know, it's one of the things that, you know, we're talking about Cena against Claudio, and I'm surprised that they've never given Claudio the title. You know, he's been shown to be a really good hand, and a lot of people are like, he doesn't have that personality. He needs a talker. But I'm just like, he's one of the greatest wrestlers they've had there in the last 15, 20 years, as far as like pure wrestlers.
I mean, for my money, he's probably the best all-around wrestler there is right now.
And that guy is incredible. Like, he's got an incredible strength. He's just, I know he's like a superhuman, you know? It's like, I've heard some crazy stories about his exercise regimen.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so I remember I used to watch him. Did you ever go to the Wrestle Jam events ever, like when they were in Connecticut?
I caught one that they did in East Haven,
I forgot
when it was. It was like about a year, I think, before I started working for PAPW or something like that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was right around that time that I was.
Was Claudio? I don't think he was there, because I remember seeing Claudio here in he wrestled that one in Hamden at the Elks Lodge, and it was you know, that guy is quite impressive. You know, it was probably like a year or so before he signed with WWE, if I remember. Mm-hmm. You know, the time. Sometimes the memory is a little hazy when it comes to time periods and when people move over, but
no, I can definitely corroborate that he was on those cards, because the show I went to was a charity show for a little girl fighting cancer, and so all their merch sales were going directly to the charity. So I bought one of their DVDs, and he was in like two or three of the matches, and that's part of the reason why I bought it. You know,
right?
Because he is one of my favorite, because just watching him in the ring, he can do stuff that no one else can do. And he makes everybody look like $1 million, and it's just so much fun to watch.
That's what he did with Cena. He made him look like $1 million. I mean, you know, that was a phenomenal match. And the funny thing about it, I'm going to say it again, it's like right there at that time period when he had that match with Cena, my immediate thought was that was such a phenomenal match to put in the belt on him next time. And they never did, you know, so I was like, I was built up for it. Like, I was really thinking that they were going to do that at that time period.
Yeah. And it's kind of funny too, because people mention the personality thing, and you know, obviously we've all had more time than normal, you know, with you know, all the pandemic stuff, not being able to go do things. Right. So one of the things that I started to watch was Xavier Woods' YouTube channel to pass the time a little bit. And he does, he plays like video games and like board games with Adam Cole, Cesaro, and Tyler Breeze.
And that's pretty interesting.
it really is. And like, obviously, if you don't like video games, like, but if you're like a big wrestling fan, like, I would say just give it a shot just because the banter between those guys is hysterical. Like, And Cesaro just shows so much personality on that channel. It's like, if you could just take like just a fraction of that and put it into a wrestling persona, you got a star.
You might get him over. All right, that's pretty interesting. One of the things that a lot of the companies are doing, you know, they can't have live crowds, or some of the indie wrestlers and some of the organizations, they're doing creating online content, and you know, some sort of online content to try to keep the names out there, to keep interest in there. And I think that's been a really good thing for the scene in general, because, you know, they can't run events. They can't run events, but I mean, they're, you know, because they don't have the money at AEW or WWE or Impact to, you know, the sponsorships to throw the money into to continue TV taping. So what's some of your favorite, outside of Xavier Woods, some of your favorite, you know, online streamers, whether it be Twitch or YouTube or what have you?
I mean, what do I do? I watch, I get most of my wrestling news from this group from actually a bunch of British guys called Cultaholic. And so they put out these news videos that come out every morning. So it's like, as I wake up, you know, as I'm, you know, getting dressed in the morning, I'll just throw on the news video. It's like, you're usually about 10-15 minutes long. So by the time, you know, I brush my teeth, throw on my clothes and whatnot, I got all my wrestling news, you know, for the day, from that. So, they're pretty good. Obviously, you know, before I moved, I had about a 25 minute half hour drive to work, depending on how long the lines were for coffee. So,
it's most important part of my day is the literally.
If I don't have it, I'm donezo. You don't want to be around me. But
I drink about a pot of coffee myself a day, and you know, and at night I've been drinking iced coffee, which is such a bad thing because I end up waking up. Like, you know, staying awake super late.
Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
No, it's all good. But now I'm much closer to work, so I don't know if I'm going to be able to keep up with the volume I did. But, you know, I've listened to a lot of the Conrad Thompson podcasts. I think he does a great job, you know, with all the research he does to get, you know, the stories out of, you know, whether it's Jim Ross, Bruce Pritchard, Arn Anderson, Schiavone, you know, whoever. He's got a great dynamic with all those guys, and you know, those are a lot of fun to listen to. They're long as hell, but they're a lot of fun to listen to.
And they really are. Speaking of the Arn Anderson one, I got this recently, so long ago. That's nice. We use that for the podcast, that logo, for a while. So
cool.
Arn Anderson, I've said this many times, is my favorite wrestler of all time. Chris Benoit is number two, but Arn is, to me, is the greatest. So. Mm-hmm. You know, so yeah, I think that's a really good podcast. Is the one with Conrad? It's just sometimes that Arn does not have a very exciting voice. It's not, you know, he has some good stories. He's just not delivering them very well. So
right. It's kind of the opposite with Schiavone. Schiavone sometimes doesn't have the best stories, but he's got a good delivery. So it's.
I think, you know, I never knew until Schiavone started doing a podcast that Schiavone was as funny as he was or that much of a dick, like, in real life, because I find it hilarious that he really is, because he always just seemed kind of like a, you know, a nerd, like a nerdy or straight, you know, straight guy.
Straight man,
and he comes in here, he says the most ridiculous stuff on his podcast sometimes, and it's really like
talking about porn stars being fans of the show. Like,
yeah, it's hilarious. His time, I like. I don't know if you did. You ever listen to Sean Mooney's podcast when it was around?
No.
Tony was a guest on there one time, and it's just that Tony talked very negatively about having to live in Connecticut while during his WWF run, saying that the basically he wasn't getting paid enough to keep a house in Connecticut, which I found interesting for, you know, such a large company. Because at that time, I think WWF was, during that golden era, it was one of the biggest peaks in 1989 to 1990. So, I know Connecticut's expensive, but that was just, wow. To hear that, working for WWF, that he couldn't afford to keep his house in state. So.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. But, yeah, no, going, listen to those podcasts. Chris Jericho, that it's been hit or miss lately, but, I mean, every now and then he's still, you know, especially, too, that he gets, like, you know, a lot of the rock and metal people on there, too.
There's, sorry to cut you off, but some of the music ones he does is really good, because it's usually, like, one episode is, like, wrestling-related. But he's also had people, like, in that do, like, Supernatural thing, you know, involved in, like, Supernatural. And sometimes they come on and it's very interesting. Like, but like I said, his podcast is really hit or miss, because sometimes I don't really enjoy it, and then there's other times he just talks about himself way too much. And we went on this whole rant last week on this show about, like, how I can't stand how he talks about himself so much.
Rick, did you know that Chris Jericho invented 3 matches that are now WWE playsets?
Is this real, or are you joking?
According to him, it is.
Oh, really?
Well, that's the only reason I said, because I have another friend who's really big into into his podcast. He's just a big Jericho fan in general, like, big fan of his wrestling, Fozzy, you know, et cetera, et cetera. But I just brought it up because there was literally about 3 podcasts in a 2-week span where he mentioned to the guest that he helped create 3 matches that are now WWE playsets.
That's interesting. I must have missed those. So I haven't listened to in a while, but I want to go back, because Thunder Rosa is on one of his most recent.
Yeah, I haven't gotten to that one yet.
And I'm a huge fan of hers. So
I don't know if she still does, but she followed me on Twitter for a while. So that was kind of,
she follows me. She follows me, which I thought was very interesting, because I never knew it. And I just went to go check something. She's following me. Holy shit. Like, she never likes anything of mine.
Right.
It's like, still. So, yeah. Yeah. So what's your favorite social media accounts, like, as far as wrestling goes?
That's really tough.
It really is.
Yeah, because for as much fun and insightful that Twitter can be, it can also be the most toxic by far.
It's very stressful.
Yeah.
So I try to back off a lot, and just, you know, the only thing I do nowadays is post these episodes every time they come out. I no longer try to communicate with anybody. I'll shoot messages to people, and that's about the extent of it.
Yeah, no, it really stinks. I mean, because that's, I mean, all I use it for is to post pictures of, you know, my collectible stuff or my wrestling stuff. You know, I don't want to, because if you start trying to, like, engage in arguments with people and stuff like that, then the next thing you know, it's like, you know, you share one opinion that may not be popular, and then 8 people you don't know are jumping on you, and that 8 turns into 80, and then you start World War III for no reason, you know, just because you said you didn't like somebody or something, and it's just, it's freaking stupid. And
people take things out of take it out of proportion, and then, you know, you can call them racist, call them fat fuck, you know, just like anything random you've called crazy. But you have to say, our good buddy Big Daddy, that's got to be my favorite social media account, because he's always pushing out content, and I always but there's, you know, like I said, you can start a war at any given second. It's happened to me before, you know, and people will just start attacking my family, you know, just searching for pictures of me and my wife, and then trying to, you know, do random stuff. I had a guy, and I ended up having to report him because he was doing all this crazy shit to my, taking my picture. So I just said, you know, social media could be the greatest thing in the world to help you grow your products, but it could also be the most evil.
Exactly. And it's just so disappointing, because I mean that's how I actually communicate with a lot of people in wrestling,
right?
Through Facebook Messenger is one of the greatest tools that I've had in this. And, you know, even Instagram, you know, you connect with people, see a picture, they see a video, they'll shoot you a message. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so it's like you said, it's a tool, and it's all in how you use it. And I wish more people used it for positive means than to just push their agenda and push people's buttons, quite frankly. And
right,
it sucks, but that's 2020 for you.
It's been a crazy year. What else outside? Yep. I mean, you work. You've done a few wrestling things that 2020 would allow.
Yes, sir.
Other than that, what have you been doing during the pandemic other than, you know, working and trying to keep busy with the other stuff?
Well, I'll tell you what, because this is something that I did on Saturday, this past Saturday. And so just to set it up, what I'll say is the last time I went to a drive-in movie theater before 2020, I was in single digits in terms of age. So this is 20-plus years ago now I'm talking. And for whatever reason, I don't know why I remember, but one of the movies that I remember seeing as a kid with my parents was at the drive-in, some drive-in movie theater was, George of the Jungle, I think it was, with Brendan Fraser,
yeah. Yeah, I remember when it came out.
Yeah. Yeah, I can't remember much from that movie, but I know that was the one. But that's one of the things I've actually done twice this year is I've gone to see movies at both of the last remaining drive-ins in Connecticut, Pleasant Valley and Mansfield. And it's something to do, you know, and because I used to love going to see movies in the theaters. You know, I would go see at least one a month, you know. Up until the pandemic started, and that all went away. But one thing that was cool was the one in Pleasant Valley, the one I saw there was it was My Spy, which was supposed to be released theatrically, but then it turned into an Amazon Prime exclusive. So I got to see a movie on a big screen that, you know, wouldn't be released on a big screen otherwise. And kind of tied in with the wrestling thing, it actually starred Dave Bautista. And he was kind of like, it was like one of those kind of like, you know, buddy cop type movies with, you know.
Know the movie you're talking about now. Yeah, I saw
like
the ads
with a little girl and stuff like that. And it was corny at parts. Yeah. But, you know, but Batista does really good as a fish out of water and those types of movies. It was entertaining. It entertained me for that night. And I just recently saw the new Mutants, the X-Men movie up in Mansfield this past weekend. Okay.
I thought there was only one drive-in left. Apparently, you just said that there was two. So that's pretty exciting because I haven't been to a drive-in theater since I was a little kid in the 80s. So single digits as well.
Yeah.
And I remember the last movie I saw in the drive-in was E.T.
Wow.
So that's how far back I'm going.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and it's such a great nostalgia feeling too. Cause I mean, we talked about, you know, the vinyl records and the VHSs, and part of the reason that I like them is just because it gives you that, you know, nostalgic feeling. And it's just so cool. You know, just, you know, sit in your car or outside your car, you know, with an AM FM battery powered transistor radio. Yeah. Getting the audio through that. And, yeah, you know, it's just, you know, the stars are out, and it's just such a cool feeling, and it's actually something I'm probably going to keep doing, you know, now that I've experienced it again. Yeah.
Do they have the concession stand, like the booth that you?
Oh yeah.
Like just like the old days. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of movies that have been pushed back, you know, until 2021 or, you know, whenever this thing is over. I know some movie theaters are open, but they're playing all older movies. I know somebody that just went and saw Major League in the theater. That movie's in the fucking theater? Like, again? Really? And they're like, yeah. It's like, they're just playing old movies. And I'm like, I don't think I'd waste my time to go see that movie in the theater. But whatever. I barely watch it when it's on cable. But a lot of movies were supposed to be, you know, theatrically released. I just watched two movies this past week. For, you know, one of them was supposed to be theatrically released, but I went to... Is it Amazon? I don't remember where, but I found it online.
Yeah.
Did you watch the third Bill and Ted movie? Did you see that yet?
What was that? You shorted out a little bit there for a second.
Sorry, probably connection issue. The Bill and Ted movie. The Bill and Ted movie that came out. Did you watch?
You know what's funny is that's playing in Mansfield next weekend. So.
Oh, okay.
And here's the thing, because I'm one of those people that like so bad they're good movies. And so the Mansfield has three screens and the new Bill and Ted is one of them. So, and the one of the other ones is Fast and the Furious Tokyo Drift. And that's by far the cheesy. Well, it's debatable, but it's cheesy, but in a fun way, you know, and, right. and that's part of its charm. And it's one of my favorite ones in that franchise. So I'm fighting because, like I said, I just moved into the condo, so I've been spending money getting things, you know, that I need. Yeah. Like, so I'm debating on whether or not I want to spend the money and go first. And then if I do, it's like, which one do I watch? Fast and the Furious, Tokyo Drift, or do I watch a new Bill and Ted? Like, it's a much harder decision than it should be. And I don't know what to do yet.
I'll tell you this much. The Bill and Ted was hard to sit through. Especially seeing, really? Like, I you know, I grew up on the first two movies and I watched them all the time on cable. And I'm just like, they're grown adults acting exactly the same as they did back then. So it's just really, really odd, you know. Another movie I watched right after that in the same day was that David Arquette documentary on his journey into professional wrestling. Have you seen it yet?
I have not. I have a digital copy of it, so it's my intent to watch it. I just haven't gotten around to it yet.
It's an amazing documentary. I mean, I'm going to tell you now, I really, really enjoyed that. So I would watch it again. It's hilarious. You know,
Really comical.
And it's funny because everybody in his family and stuff thinks he's nuts at like 48 years old getting into professional wrestling. Yeah. Whatever.
Hey, I got to give the guy all the credit in the world because
absolutely,
you know, he even acknowledges that the WCW situation that he was in was a complete mess, and it's just the fact that he wanted to go out and redeem himself by doing it the right way, going through the indies, and that's just it takes a lot of balls to do that, and so I give him a lot of credit.
I just got to say this: it's not his fault. You know, he's just doing what he was told to do. And, you know, it's just, but people are right off the bat in the beginning of the documentary, they're like, he killed WCW. It was his fault. He's just getting paid to do whatever he's doing, you know. So, yeah. But he donated all the money. WCW. That was a lot worse. He donated all the money that he made in WCW to, like, you know, Brian Pillman's family, apparently.
Right.
And, you know, and other families and such, the wrestlers that had passed their families. So anyways, Matt, do you have anything else to add tonight?
Well, let's see. I'm just going to do a couple cheap plugs on what I got coming up next.
Absolutely.
Yes, the next place that Matt DeCourt will be as of right now is, I believe it's the, hold on, let me check my trusty calendar here. Yes, right. Saturday, September 26th, I believe that's in a couple weeks. I'll be back at Ryder's Bar and Smokehouse up in Thomaston for Test of Strength, Fight for Your Dreams 3. That's shaping up to be a heck of a card, so if you're able to, they got an outdoor event that's going to be under Pavilion. Last time, it was great atmosphere. A lot of people came out. Looking forward to another good show with Test of Strength. And then after that, October 3rd, we have the Paradise Alley Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame ceremony.
I'm looking forward to that one.
Oh, absolutely. We got the four previously announced inductees: Big Steve Tracy, Paul Perez, the Guardian of Chaos Big Daddy, Sergeant Murray. And I just read today that the fifth inductee is Mario Mancini. So,
congratulations, gentlemen.
Yep. Absolutely. Big congrats to all of them. Looking forward to seeing their inductions. And also, I think there's going to be a few matches that night as well.
Okay, that's great to hear.
Yeah, so definitely looking forward to that. And after that, PAPW will be back for an outdoor event at our home away from home, the Anatole. And that's shaping up to be really good, too. I think Trayvon Jordan's on that card. Nutrius X is going to be back. You know, all the PAPW originals, all the PAPW favorites. Richard Holiday, I believe, is going to be there. MLW star Richard Holiday. So that's shaping up to be good. And a lot of the PAPW guys too are going to have signed with the North American Wrestling Alliance (NAWA). They're going to be coming back. If you're a fan of old school wrestling, I know you are, Rick. So that'll be right up your alley, and I hope it'll be right up some other people's alleys as well. So definitely support all these promotions. Blood, Sweat, and Tears will be back soon. I'm just waiting to hear back from them on the date. Flash Waller's going to be taking on Lucas Chase. That, like I said, that's been brewing. That's been really awesome. So there's a lot of good things in the pipeline coming here in Connecticut in terms of local wrestling. So, and I'm very glad to be a part of it, and I hope I can continue to be a part of it for as long as I can. And I hope I can continue to see you and a lot of all the other regulars at all the events.
You know, I'm going to be at any show I can get to. You know that.
Oh, absolutely, my friend.
Especially the Paradise Alley shows. One more thing. Why don't you tell everybody where they can find you on the interwebs?
Absolutely. You can find me on Facebook. I am Matt Decorte, D-A-C-O-R-T-E. If you need to remember my last name, a friend of mine in college used to say, if you got a ticket, you take it to Decorte. I know, cheesy as hell, right? But anyways, so I am Matt Decorte on Facebook, D-A-C-O-R-T-E. You can find me at M-J-D-A-C-O-R-T-E on Twitter and Instagram. Like I said, I just post, you know, pictures of me in a suit with a microphone, yelling people's names or stuff that's in my various collections. So if you're a fan of geek culture and pro wrestling, definitely check it out.
Well, there you go, Matt. Thank you so much for coming on, buddy.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me, Rick. It was an absolute pleasure. I loved it.
Thank you.
That's all, folks.